Welcome back. In the last video, we derived Gauss's Divergence Theorem, which is an extremely powerful equality in vector calculus that allows us to derive partial differential equations. So in particular, what Gauss's theorem allows us to do is equate the flux of a quantity through some surface S, given by, let's say I have a fluid flow given by this vector field F, and that fluid flow is moving material, mass, and energy, and momentum around in space. And if I want to compute how much of that quantity is passing through this surface S, I can compute that one of two ways. I can either compute that by integrating this vector field F, dot it into the normal direction, and integrate that along the surface. That would essentially add up how all of the stuff is moving through the surface. Or, equivalently, and this is Gauss's divergence theorem, I can compute the divergence of F everywhere in this volume and integrate up all of those divergences over the entire volume. So it essentially gives us a way of equating a volume integral of divergences that equals a surface integral of this F dotted into the normal. And we used it in the last lecture to derive this mass conservation equation, this mass continuity partial differential equation, assuming that we have some fluid flow carrying mass, that has some density rho. So rho is the density of my fluid in all of space and time. It's a scalar function. And this vector field F is moving mass around. It's just moving air or water around, let's say in the atmosphere or in the ocean or something like that. And so we could write that the total rate of change of mass in my volume is equal to the amount of mass that is being carried in and carried out of that volume by the fluid. So if I have a total net amount of fluid leaving the volume, so F dot N is positive, if I have a total amount of fluid leaving the volume through the surface of this, then that would correspond to a negative rate of change of mass inside the volume. This is just basic accounting. And again, Gauss's divergence theorem says that I can take this surface integral, integrating up around the surface, and I can write that as a volume integral for the divergence of that quantity that I'm computing. And so maybe I'll just make this very explicit. This step here is where we used Gauss's theorem. Okay? So this step from the surface integral to this volume integral is how we used Gauss's divergence theorem. That allowed us to take this quantity here, which is in a volume integral, and get another expression under a volume integral, so I can have them kind of under the same volume integral. And what we said is that this is true for all volumes V, and so essentially if this is true for all volumes, you get this partial differential equation. So the thing inside has to equal zero if this integral is equal to zero for all volumes V. That's just kind of a nice physical argument. Now I want to do a few things here. I want to point out these conservation laws are extremely powerful. If you draw a volume, a sufficiently large volume V, this is called a control volume, sometimes in fluids or in physics. This can include things like, if there is a nuclear bomb going off in that, or if I have, some Death Star creating, some focused laser that explodes a planet. Okay, if my control volume is large enough that it includes all of those effects, and it's kind of, large enough that it includes that, then this basic conservation is still going to be true inside of this volume. So it's a very, very powerful idea is to compute these integrals over these volumes. A couple things I want to point out that I did not include in my last lecture, and I want to make this a little more general. So the total rate of change of mass in my volume is equal to the amount of mass carried out of the volume or into the volume, but you can also have plus a source term, some volume integral of a source term dV. So for example, if I actually detonated a nuclear bomb inside of my control volume, I'm actually converting mass purely into energy, and so I actually would have a negative Q very locally at this point. I would have a negative Q, and I'd have to integrate that up over the volume. So technically speaking, my expression here is only true if mass is neither created nor destroyed, if the quantity I'm conserving is not created or destroyed. But if you can have a source of Q, either, you know, maybe you you create mass from energy, or maybe you destroy mass and it turns into energy, then you can have these source terms added to this equation. And it would basically be this equation equals, you know, a source term. There would be some source term in space and time forcing this partial differential equation. Okay, so that's one important thing, is that we need to think about, is the assumption of mass conservation really true? For a simple fluid flow, if I just follow, you know, the fluid flow in the ocean, absolutely, mass is not being created or destroyed. If I follow, you know, the air in the atmosphere, even if a jet's flying through it, mass is not being created or destroyed. But sometimes when I have a complicated enough physical process, like, you know, I'm actually fusing atoms or splitting atoms, then I might actually have to have these source terms here. But that's the really cool thing about kind of partial differential equations and control volumes and Gauss's theorem, is that you can still apply these arguments if you're careful, even, you know, if your control volume has really gnarly physics going on. Now, everything is always true in the control volume sense. This is always true, this expression here, okay, the one that I've written here and I'm highlighting with my hand, always true. When we convert it into this expression here using Gauss's divergence theorem, and when we say that this is true for all volumes V, to get this partial differential equation, that step relies on the quantity we're saying is conserved, mass, momentum, energy, and the fluid flow that's carrying it around, F, being sufficiently smooth or continuous that I can kind of take the limit over any volume and still have this be true. And remember that picture I showed with the divergence where we kind of split this into a bunch of boxes and we had a bunch of local divergences that canceled out? If I have an abrupt enough change in my vector field, so it abruptly changes like that, if I have a shock function, you know, a step function in F, or I have a shock wave, so I have an instantaneous change in rho, then that argument, that pillbox argument that Gauss's theorem is derived on, that these are essentially canceling each other out, that kind of breaks down, okay? And so that just gives you some idea that if your F or your rho, if the thing you're carrying around, and if the vector field that's carrying it around, if those are discontinuous, then you can't kind of take this step here, the Gauss's theorem step, and you can't remove this volume integral. Because if I have a discontinuous rho or F, these will kind of blow up to infinity. I can't compute the derivative of a step function and have it still be finite. So this doesn't really make sense for discontinuous functions like shock waves. And so that's actually why, if we look at supersonic jets, I really need to think about it in a control volume setting. It's harder to think about it using these PDEs. Okay, so that's, I think, something I really wanted to point out, just so that you know, you can include kind of other physics like sources and sinks, you know, creation and destruction of mass through these source terms. And the step where we go from a volume integral to a partial differential equation relies on things being smooth. This doesn't work for shock waves and discontinuous dynamics. You kind of have to work in the control volume if that's the case. And you can still compute these things approximately numerically, and so that's okay. We can still compute, you know, what happens, but we sometimes have to use different computational strategies. Good. Now what I want to point out is if rho is constant, so if rho is constant, then we have an incompressible flow. Literally means, like, if you take liquid water is very, very hard to compress. It's very hard to change the density of your water. You can smash it, you can, you know, accelerate it, you can do all this stuff. The density of your water is not going to change much, okay? And so that's an incompressible fluid. Air, the air that is around us, if I just wave my arms or move, my mouth or whatever, that air is also approximately incompressible on these timescales. If I just move my hand, I can feel a breeze, but that density is really not changing just because I'm moving my hands. You have to go, you know, close to the speed of sound, so you have to go to like Mach 0.3 or 0.1 or, you know, some appreciable fraction of the speed of sound before you actually start stacking up and compressing the air and changing its density in space and time. So my point being that this equation is general enough to handle fully compressible fluid flows where the density changes. This is okay, you know, for jets flying where the density of the air is actually changing because they're kind of ramming the air together and forming these kind of density waves. But if the air or the water is incompressible, if the density doesn't change at all, then we can derive special conditions on this differential equation. So that's what I want to do now. And this is kind of an exercise to get you thinking about how you can manipulate these things with more physical knowledge. So here we only use mass conservation. But again, if we know something extra, like we have constant density, we can do even more. We can simplify this even more. So let's do that. What I'm going to do is I am going to actually compute what this term looks like. So if I have del dot rho f, and again, we're going to assume that f has three components. Let's say that this is f1, f2, f3, and these are all functions of x, y, and z and time. Okay, so this is an unsteady flow in space and time. Then this is equal to partial x of rho f1 plus partial y of rho f2 plus partial z of rho f3. And I feel like I'm going to make a typo, so just please follow along carefully and make sure that you agree with this. Now, if rho can vary, then I actually have to compute this derivative using the chain rule. This would be partial rho partial x f1 plus rho partial f1 partial x. And so I'm actually going to write this out. Maybe I'll change colors here. So this equals, and I'm going to use subscript to denote partial derivative. So this would equal rho sub x f1 plus rho f1 sub x, that's the partial of f1 with respect to x. Okay, that's the first term. Plus, same thing, rho sub y f2 plus rho f2 sub y. And now the third term is rho sub z f3 plus rho f3 sub z, partial of f3 with respect to z. And I can collect my terms here. I can collect my like terms. I can take all of my rows that have no partial derivatives, and I can take all of my rows that do have partial derivatives, and I can bring those into two different expressions. And so what this equals is, this equals all of my, let's take my yellow terms first here. So this is rho times the divergence of f. This is rho times div dot f. Okay, that's, you know, partial of f1 with respect to x plus partial of f2 with respect to y plus partial of f3 with respect to z. That's the divergence of f. So these yellow terms are just rho times the divergence of f. The pink terms are the gradient of rho, literally grad rho, rho sub x, rho sub y, rho sub z, dotted with f. So rho sub x times the first component of f, rho sub y times the second component of f, rho sub z times the third component of f. That's the gradient of rho dotted with f. And so I'm just showing you kind of what we do when we kind of do the chain rule to this expression here. My divergence of rho times f, the momentum, the mass that's being carried through with f, gives me these two terms here. So here's where it gets interesting. Okay, if I gotta give myself a place to live, if the fluid is incompressible fluid, like water, liquid water is a great example, or I don't know if mercury is incompressible, I guess it is. If my fluid is incompressible, I guess liquids in general are incompressible typically. If my fluid is incompressible, then rho is a constant. The density is a constant. The density can't be changed just by moving the fluid around. And if the density is constant, then what that means is that partial rho partial t is equal to zero, like it can't change in time. And the gradient of rho is equal to zero. Rho doesn't change as I move along in x or y or z. Okay, it's a constant. And so if my fluid is incompressible, so if my density is a constant, if rho is a constant, then these two things have to be true. And what that means is that this term is zero. And when I split this into these two terms, the pink term has to be zero also. And so what I end up getting when I expand this out, I have partial rho partial t plus rho divergence of f plus gradient of rho dotted with f. All of that equals, again, this originally equaled zero when I didn't have when I didn't have some source term. This all equaled zero. But because of my incompressibility, this term is zero, and the gradient of rho is equal to zero. And so, and rho is a constant. I can just divide both sides by rho. And so what that means is that I have, for an incompressible flow, the divergence of my fluid vector field F has to equal zero. Again, this is the mass continuity equation for incompressible flows. This means that my flows have to be divergence free. So if I have the flow of liquid water, you know, around the ocean, kind of the Gulf Stream or whatever, that flow has to be divergence free to satisfy the incompressibility of rho. And that's a really, really powerful result. Again, we used Gauss's theorem to derive the basic partial differential equation for how mass moves around in a fluid. And that can include all kinds of weird effects, you know, compressible effects. But if we know that our fluid is incompressible, like liquid water, so we know that rho is a constant, we can do things like kill off different terms in the equation and get a simpler expression for that vector field F. So this divergence-free condition, or this kind of continuity equation, the divergence of F equals zero, is a really, really important equation for incompressible flows. This is a statement of conservation of mass for incompressible flows. If my density doesn't change, this is how mass is conserved. Okay, so that gives you an idea of kind of some of the caveats, how you can extend this to include even more interesting physics, when you can and cannot go from a volume integral to a real, honest-to-goodness partial differential equation. For example, if you have shockwaves in your flow or discontinuities, supersonic jets would be a case like that. And then also how, if you have extra knowledge about your fluid, if you know something about this flow, like the density is constant for incompressible flows, then you can get even simpler expressions, like this is the exact same expression for an incompressible flow. So really cool stuff. We can also use this kind of basic framework. Instead of carrying around mass conservation in a volume, we could keep track of the conservation of momentum in a volume. And we would derive, instead of the continuity equation, the Navier-Stokes equations. So the Navier-Stokes equations are kind of this exact procedure for the conservation of momentum in a volume with a fluid carrying it around. You could also do this for the conservation of energy. Again, if you had thermal flows or, you know, combusting flows or, you know, nuclear blast flows, you'd need an energy equation to keep track of kind of the thermodynamics of the situation too. But again, as long as you know basic conservation laws, that stuff just doesn't come from nowhere, you know, there's source terms and sink terms maybe, you can derive these PDEs and analyze them. All right, thank you.